I want to show up hands. How many here are familiar with GraphQL and Apollo? Very few, right? And how many are already using GraphQL and Apollo in some sort of app? No one. Oh, one. Okay. Hopefully, by end of this talk, I'll try to convince you to use GraphQL and Apollo interactions. I work as a freelancer and my portfolio website is redux.com, and I also organize React Days Bangalore, which is a freelance group in Bangalore. In this talk, I will share my experience with migrating an app from REST-based backend to GraphQL-based backend and moving from Redux to Apollo. So, let's talk about our app. You know, we are working on this energy auditing software, and this energy auditing software is kind of very data intensive application, right? We have like queues, like we have like lot of tables, and there are like relations between these tables, and it's kind of, you know, very data intensive application, and we have like lot of network intensive features like live editing. For example, on every keystroke, we have to save that updates to the backend. And we need this real-time data syncing. In a sense, if multiple users are using the app at a time, if one user edits something, rest of the users should get the update instantly. And we need to support, we need to have offline support. In a sense, you know, for example, if the person is using the energy auditing software and he is offline, and he made some edits in the app, and when he comes back online, all the edits he has made should be saved into the database, right? So if you think about it, it's kind of, these are the kind of common problems most CRM applications will have, right? Yeah, so 2 years back, we kind of, you know, evaluated the stack and we chose the best stack we have at that time, right? We have used the REST-based Node.js server at the backend, and we use React plus Redux for the front end, which is like 2 years back. That's the best we have at the time, and we wrote the app. It works well. But because, as I said, you know, we have like a lot of complex features, so we started writing a lot of custom abstractions, right? Because to manage that all the complexity we have in the app, we are writing a lot of code and we are writing a lot of abstractions. And we were able to get the app working, but the downside of this writing lot of abstractions is it's very hard for a new developer to onboard, right? A new developer comes and he sees the code and says, I never saw this code. This is the first time I am seeing this, something like this. And it's very hard for the new developers to understand this abstraction. So we were in search of simplifying our stack, and you know, we researched on what we can do to simplify our app. And in that research, we found GraphQL. Right? After some research, we found that if we move our backend to the GraphQL, we can simplify a lot of our backend logic. For those who are not familiar with GraphQL, I'll give a quick intro about GraphQL. So GraphQL is a query language for APIs and a runtime for fulfilling those queries with your existing data. So I'll explain what this means. Right? So in GraphQL, we define a schema according to our data model. For example, let's say we are building an app, e-commerce app, which has a user, products, orders, cart, so on and so forth, right? We have like a lot of data models. For each model, we'll define tags. For example, if the user has a first name, last name, overall the page, we define the tags and we define resolvers. You know, how to calculate that. For example, if we have a user, how to compute that particular user. That's how we'll be working with the GraphQL, right? We don't have any endpoints, and we just define our backend model and we pass that schema to the server, and the server, the GraphQL server works. You know, for example, if you want to see an example of the type, you can see we have a type called user and it has an ID which is of type int, and we have a first name which is of type string, and last name which is of type string. So you can see there is a back at the end, which means it's required. It's not optional, it's required. For example, every user should have an ID, every user should have a first name, but the last name is optional. Right? So in the GraphQL, for entire data model of our application, we define these types for all them, and we define and this is the description of types, and the second part is resolvers. In the resolvers, we write logic for how to compute these properties, right? And once you have that, you can pass this schema to a server, and what the server does is it gets a query from the client, and based on the client, based on the query, it calculates the response and just returns back that data to the server. So you can see some of the examples for this query. For example, in the left you can see a GraphQL query. Here we are saying that we need a user, and inside that user I want ID and first name, right? So this is the query which the client is sent, and our GraphQL server will respond with a JSON data, right? And at the end we want the JSON data, so it returns ID and first name, right? Again, how this data is calculated based on our resolvers. And you can see that the user might be having a lot more fields, but in the response we only got ID and first name because that's what the client asked for. For example, if the user asks for the client asks for last name also, then the server responds with last name. You can see there is a major contrast with the rest, right? In the rest, we hit an endpoint, we get all the data, right, based on our implementation. But this is like completely contrast, right? In the GraphQL, the client is asking for what it wants, and based on its requirement, the GraphQL is resolving that and giving it. And it doesn't stop here. We can ask multiple objects in a single query. For example, we can say, I want user with ID, and I also want products with ID and name, right? With a single query, you are able to get two types of objects, right? And this can expand. And this query can be nested as well, and there can be relations. For example, the product can be can have a seller, and which could, and the seller could be a user, right? There could be relations as well, and the queries could be very nested as well. So you can see here, right? So the GraphQL doesn't have the concept of endpoints. Just have one endpoint, and the client sends the query, and the server gets the response. Yeah, so again, in GraphQL, we do not worry about the endpoints at all, and we focus on our data model, right? We know what kind of data properties we have in our applications. We define the data model, we define how that can be calculated, right? And if you think about it, and again, the client queries what it wants, and the client gets based on the query. And if you think about it, the server implementation based on this architecture will be much more simple to implement and much more scalable. We need not worry about implementing an endpoint for mobile, implementing an endpoint for desktop, and we need not worry about managing the names of the endpoints and so on and so forth. So that's about the story of our backend. We moved our backend to the GraphQL, and because we have like a lot of data models, and our server implementation became much more clean to understand, and you know, much more scalable. And then we moved on to the front end, right? And in the front end, it doesn't matter. React is same. React, we have like this declarative model, and React works same. Whether we use Redux, GraphQL, REST, React is same. But the tricky part is the state management, right? If you think about the state management, front end state management, there are like two types of state. One is the local state. Some examples could be whatever data we enter in a form, or we click on a button and a model opens, right? Whether the model is open or not. So that's the local state. And it's generally synchronous, right? We take some action, and the state is calculated immediately. It's synchronous. And the second type of state is called remote state, right? This is the data we get from the server, and we can treat this as like data coming from the server, or if the data is coming via sockets with the real time updates. So this is the remote data. This is generally asynchronous because the client has to request or someone has to initiate some transaction, and after some time we get the data. So this is asynchronous in nature. So generally, local state management is easy, whether you use Redux, mobiles, any state management library, managing local state is easy. The tricky part is managing the remote data. You know, there are several problems or several common problems with the remote data management. One example is like having an efficient data format. So for example, let's say we are fetching a list of products, right? If we save the products as an array, we could have like some performance issues. In a sense, and if we are doing a lot of modifications to this array, every time, for example, if you want to edit the product ID 1, you have to find that product ID 1 in an array, do the manipulations, and then again inside it. Right? Generally, array lookups and array manipulations are inefficient. Right? So we might want to use object-based lookups. In the sense, you know, we get the products as an array from the server, but we transform it and save it as an object. In the sense, you know, we'll have an object inside the products, we'll have something called by ID. And the key of that object will be the ID of that thing, but the value will be the actual data. So here what happens is, when we want the product ID 1, we just object reference is much more efficient, right? We directly get that data. And to preserve the order of the product, we store another property called IDs, where we store the order of IDs, right? So if you want to optimize your application for performance, we generally follow the object-based lookup approach. Right? You might be following some of these practices in Redux if you are following the best practices, right? And if you can, if you think about it, implementing something like transforming the array to objects and managing the order and everything, this involves a lot of data, right? So a lot of logic. Again, other problems like managing the loading state. For example, we initiate a transaction to the server, and server takes some time to give the response, right? And it there is a gap, and meanwhile we have to show some spinner or something. We have to manage the loading state. Again, which involves some logic to write. And we have to cache. For example, we fetch the list of products, and if we already have the data in our cache, there is no point in sending the same request again. But then, we have to write some logic to make sure that we have the correct data and we are not missing out on something, right? We need to write some extra logic. And what if we make a request, we got some errors, we have to handle those errors. And this goes on and on. The point I'm trying to get is, we have like several common network problems, and which are common across multiple applications, right? And earlier we used Redux, and Redux was primarily designed for local state management. It worked very well, but the only problem we faced is, we have to write a lot of logic for all these cases, right? We can use Redux for handling remote data with the help of middlewares. We can use Redux Tan, Redux Log or something. But still, we have to write some logic for all the network management problems which I mentioned before. On the contrary, Apollo is designed to interact with GraphQL. You know, Apollo is designed to interact with asynchronous data. And Apollo can also be used for local state management, because Apollo was designed for dealing with network. It got out of the box solutions for all the network problems which I mentioned again. So without writing any logic at all, we can get solutions for them. Let's take a simple example and compare the effort that requires to implement the same thing in Redux versus Apollo. Right? Let's start. Let's say we want to fetch a list of products from the server and pass it to a product list component, right? And we can use a connect component, assuming we have the data in our Redux store, we can use a connect component. We can write a map stripping props which picks the product data from the store and pass it to our component as a prop. And we can also implement a function called fetch products and bind our dispatch to that and pass it to our products component, right? And once we have that fetch products thing, right? We have to invoke it, otherwise that request doesn't go to the server, right? There are a couple of places where we can invoke in the route chain, and another way is we can wait in the component demount, right? And on the component demount of the product list page, we initiate this request, we get the data, right? Let's look at the logic which we have to write in the fetch products thing, right? And again, we are using Redux Tan, right? Because Redux doesn't support asynchronous actions. But the fetch products is an asynchronous. It has to make a call to the server, and we have to use some middleware. In this example, I'm using Redux Tan, right? And in this Redux Tan, this action will return another function which gets dispatched as the first argument, right? And initially, we dispatch an action called products request, because because we have to maintain that loading state, right? So before even making an API call, we dispatch an action called product request, so that you know we can track that you know this request is going out. Once we dispatch that, we'll actually make the API call, we get the response, we check if there are any errors, right? If there are any errors, we'll throw it, throw the error, otherwise we'll just convert it to JSON. If we successfully get the data, right? We dispatch another action called product request success with a payload for the product data, right? And if it's a failure, we dispatch another action called product request failure with an error message, right? And so that's the action part. Let's look at the register part. And here, we have to handle all the three actions which we dispatched previously. Initially, we have product request, right? And we have to set loading to true, then this action got triggered. And during the success, we'll set the loading state to false, but since we got the product data, we'll set it on the register, right? If there is an error, we'll again turn off the loading state and set the error. You can see that here, we have written a lot of logic for the very simple case, right? I haven't even mentioned about the data transformation, caching, for the simple use case of fetching the data from the server and passing it to the component, we have written a lot of logic. Let's see how we can implement the same thing with Apollo. In Apollo, again, I'm importing GQL, which is a GraphQL tag, and GraphQL, which is a higher order component, and then I'm writing a GraphQL query. So what this query will have is, we'll specify what data we need. In this case, we are saying that we want product data, right? And inside that, I want ID, name, and price, right? We specify the query and pass that query to the higher order component. We'll wrap our product's list component with the GraphQL higher order component, pass this query to that component. That's it. That's all we have to do, right? Apollo takes care of actually taking the request. We need to initiate the request. Apollo initiates the request, gets the data, and while it's getting the data, it also passes the loading state. It passes the proper loading, right? Based on that, we can track whether the request is going or not. And once the request is resolved, it actually passes the product data to our component, right? So you can see in the previous, like four slides just in the Redux, but in Apollo, we write the query, wrap our component with our query, and that's done. You can see that, you know, this approach is very declarative, and the developer experience will be much higher compared to the Redux implementation, right? Because we are writing very less code, and we are declaratively defining what our application needs, and delegating all the hard work to the operator. And again, it does much more than what our previous Redux code does. In the sense, it normalizes the data, and it caches the data. For example, if another component requests the same products, Apollo doesn't send that request to the server because it knows that it already has the data, it caches the data, and it knows that it already has the data, it doesn't send that request. And also, normalize. For example, in this example, if you see, we have products, and inside that we have two product objects, like product 1 and product 2. And again, there is another property called cart items. Inside that we have an ID and product, right? And inside that we have product ID. But you can see that product ID, the product one is stored only once. Like Apollo normalizes the data and doesn't duplicate the data. In a sense, you know, even the cart item is referring to product one, and even the product list is referring to product one. It stores the data separately and it just refers to that particular data, right? So in this case, both the product in the cart items and the product list are written to the same object, right? We have like the data consistency as well. And it's much more memory. And again, it avoids leakages because you know it knows what data is already there in the cache. And so far we were looking at reads, and the same thing can be applied for writes and real-time updates as well. Let's take a look at it. In the case of GraphQL board, we call the writes to server as mutation, right? And GraphQL is a very tricky type. In the sense, you know, for example, if you want to make a write, for example, let's say we want to add to cart, right? We want to execute a mutation called add to cart. What kind of information would be needing? So let's say we want to view product ID, right? And it's of type int. We have to specify the type, and inside that we'll be actually saying that call this add to cart to the product ID, which is passed, right? And we need this kind of syntax when we want to pass variables, right? if you are doing static things, like if you just say mutation, add to cart, product ID 1, right? If you are not using variables, you can directly write that. But in this case, we want a generic mutation, right? And we should be able to pass this generic mutation to any component. And for that reason, we have to use variables. So the dollar mutations is a way of using variables in GraphQL syntax. And again, this is a part of GraphQL spec. Right? And we write this GraphQL mutation. Again, we just wrap our button with this GraphQL hierarchy component and just pass this mutation query to them. Right? And once you have done that, again, invoking the mutation, right? For example, mutations we have to use has to invoke. It's not that Apollo can do it because you know it's mutations are based on users' interactions, right? It can't be done automatically. So we can attach it to the object handler, for example, when the user clicks on the add to cart button, then we execute this mutation, right? And if invoking the mutation is easy, then we pass that higher order component. When we pass our query to this higher order component, we get this function called mutate, right? And inside that mutate, we can call this mutate function with variables. In this case, we are passing the product. Similar query pattern for both local state management as well as the remote data management. And we can even mix and match. For example, let's say we have a list of products. We are getting the properties like ID, name, and price from the server. But we have a property called isSelected. And the user clicks on the checkbox, that one got checked, but that data is just stored locally. Right? Now we can combine both the data, like the data coming from the server and the local state as well, make a single query. Now the data like our products array with the properties ID, name, price, isSelected will go to our product list component. But ID, name, and price are coming from the server, but isSelected is coming from the local state. Right? This makes our data much more concise and you know very reusable. And even mutations with local state is much easier than you know mutations for server. Or because again as I said, local state management is mostly synchronous, right? We compute the new value and just directly write it to our cache. And again for the local state management, we are directly dealing with the cache. So recently Apollo introduced a new component called Apollo Consumer, which follows the render prop or contest API, which was discussed today morning. And when we pass a chain function to this Apollo consumer will pass a cache to our chain function, right? And we can directly update our chain function. For example, let's say we have shown the relationship property, and we can compute the new property based on our requirement and set it in our cache, right? And if you want to read this property, we can write the query which I have shown previously. Right. Mutations is for the mutations of local state management, we can directly update the cache. For reading, we can use the queries which are shown previously. And so this local state management, as I said, you know, in Apollo 2.0, local state management is possible. It is possible because of this new feature or new implementation called Apollo Link Interface. Right? And Apollo by default supports a lot of network problems like caching, pagination, whatnot. It supports a lot of it, but sometimes you want some extra features which are not supported by the Apollo, right? Which are common but not too common for Apollo to implement. So we can extend the Apollo with our own implementation. For example, we can write some middleware kind of logic to extend the behavior of the Apollo, right? This link interface is almost similar to middleware logic in the sense, you know, when we write a query, that query will pass through the link interfaces, finally go to the server, and then the server returns with the data, and again that data will pass through all these link interfaces and finally end in the cache. Well, because we have this two-way flow, we can intercept. In a sense, for example, let's say we want to implement offline storage, right? Offline, we want to implement offline support for our application. In the sense, the user goes offline, we still want to track all the mutations created by the user, but once the user comes back online, you want to send them back to the server, right? You can, there is an open source link interface called Apollo Link U. We can install it and import it and add it to our link. For example, HTTP link is responsible for making queries to this GraphQL server. And we can add this extra link called Apollo Link imprint on the HTTP link. After adding this offline link, what happens is if the user goes offline, all the mutations will be stored in a queue, and then the user gets back online, all the mutations will go to the server, and the client data will be you can write and open source them, and more people can use it. Or if our use case is very specific to our application, we can write our own linked address and add it ourselves, right? This is kind of Apollo's kind of very extensible as well. So after migrating our code to GraphQL and Apollo, so we have seen a lot of reduction of the code, which is a nice thing, right? The less code we have, less bugs we have, and the less maintainability problems we have. And the code is much more declarative, both on the server and on the client, right? We have to, getting the data from the server, all we have to do is write a query and wrap it to our components. And the code is much more declarative. And we got rid of a lot of abstractions we have written, because we are following the well-documented patterns. The new developers can pick up easily because they have some issues. They go to the Apollo GraphQL docs and find it, or they go to Stack Overflow and ask someone. They'll get the help, because we are not following our own custom abstractions. We are following well-defined patterns, right? So it's much easier for new developers to come and work on the project. And again, as I said, because of the link interface, right? People can start contributing to the Apollo, and people can extend the Apollo library and open source small modules, which can be very useful. Similar to the Apollo link view library, which I mentioned. That's not it. GraphQL stack is not done yet, and it's still evolving. In the sense, already it does a lot of work, but it's still evolving. For example, Facebook is working on a new feature called live queries. Right? It's not part of the stack and it's not implemented yet. It's highly estimated. And so how it works is, let's say we wrote a query called products, and either we are expecting properties called ID and name. And to make it a live query, we will add a directive called @line. Right? If we add that, now our client data will be in sync with the server data. If the product data has changed on the server after making the query, GraphQL will make sure that the server data is in sync with the query without writing any code at all. Right? We are getting reactive UI without writing any code. We don't need to implement subscriptions, or we don't need to implement sockets or anything. All we have to do is we wrote a query and we add @line. Now our server and client are completely in sync. Right? It's kind of very powerful feature. I hope it gets released very soon. And one more, there is one more library called Prisma. Right? How the Prisma works is, it's kind of that we write tags, GraphQL tags in Prisma, and give it to the Prisma tool, and Prisma will automatically give us a GraphQL endpoint. It takes care of making creating tables to the database. It takes care of handling the migrations. It takes care of giving us the GraphQL, basic GraphQL server, right? All we have to do is, we define our data model as a type, which is kind of very declarative. You can see, for example, here, I have a type of product, in that I will say ID, and in that ID is of type link, which is required, and it should be unique. So you are seeing at the range unique, because it's kind of database construct, right? In databases, we want IDs to be unique. So that's the reason we are saying @unique, and in that we have a name, which is a string. When we write this and pass it to Prisma tool, Prisma creates a table in the database. It could be MySQL, Postgres, MongoDB, any database, right? We can connect to any database. Prisma automatically creates the table, and we can start interacting with our database directly, with Apollo or any other GraphQL kind. It's kind of very powerful, right? So the amount of server code we have to write significantly reduces. We can still write a layer on top of this to implement some business logic, but with, the initial will be significantly reduced with the help of this kind of tools. So the reason I'm pointing about live queries and Prisma is because, we have this GraphQL spec, which is kind of evolving, and based on this spec, we get kind of, a lot of very good tools like Prisma. Again, I think of GraphQL as an API for modern era, just like how React has revolutionized the UI development, right? I believe that GraphQL and Apollo will revolutionize Prisma and give it to the Prisma tool, and Prisma will automatically give us a GraphQL endpoint. It takes care of making creating tables to the database, it takes care of handling the migrations, it takes care of giving us the GraphQL, basic GraphQL server, right? All we have to do is we define our data model as a type, which is kind of very different. You can see, for example, here I have a type of product that I'll say ID, and that ID not ID, which is required, and it should be unique. So you are looking at very unique because it's kind of database construct, right? In database, we want IDs to be unique. So that's the reason we are saying that very unique, and in that we have a name, which is a string. When you write this and pass it to Prisma 2, Prisma creates a table in the database. It could be MySQL, Postgres, MongoDB, any database, right? It can connect any database. Prisma automatically creates the table and we can start interacting with our database directly with Apollo or any other subscription. It's kind of very powerful, right? So that's one of server code we have to write things in capabilities. You can still write a layer on top of this to do it some business logic, but it's, the initial inertia will be significantly reduced when we have all these kind of tools. So the reason I'm pointing out libraries and Prisma is because, you know, we have this GraphQL stack which is kind of evolving, and based on this stack we get kind of, you know, lot of very good tools like this. Again, I think of GraphQL as an API for modern era. Just like how React has revolutionized the UI development, right? I believe that GraphQL and Apollo will revolutionize how we interact with our server and how we develop our backends, right? And again, React has brought this declarative paradigm to our UI development. I believe that GraphQL and Apollo will bring the same declarativeness to how we how the clients communicate with the server and how the servers are developed. Again, GraphQL plus Apollo plus React is an awesome stack. And I hope you give it a try and see how it works out. So that's all I have. I'm Kevin Aburi at Twitter, and I have created a very basic application, basic e-commerce application, and you can find it at the link. See how it looks, and if you have any questions, you can reach out to me again.